There was a gentleman who graduated from Wendell Phillips High School in 1949, 1950. He had aspirations of going to West Point and being a military man. Well, things didn't quite work out for him, so he got involved in a lot of different ventures. One of the things he got involved in was music, and he became the manager for a group called the Roosters. Well, he told them that being a rooster won't sell a lot of records. You got to do something to impress the people. Well, they went on and they changed their name to the Impressions. And the rest is history. Well, that gentleman's name is Eddie Thomas. He was inducted into the Wendell Phillips Hall of Fame in the year 2006. And just sitting down and talking to Eddie Thomas, it's like going through a musical history.
I wanted a military career because of my mother, low finances, and my stepfather was a musician, and he didn't make a lot of money around the city. He toured over different nightclubs. So I thought maybe if I could get an appointment at West Point Military Academy, which is be free tuition, no problem, I just have to qualify for that. That's what I would shoot for. So when I started in high school, I set my goals for that. I joined the ROTC, became an officer. I did very well in my studies. And in my last year, I went to the late Congressman William L. Dawson and told him what I would like. He looked over my school records and saw that I did very well. He told me to come back within a week, he'll let me know. He called me 2 days later and told me to come in. I got the appointment to go to West Point Military Academy. I was very excited, very happy, and just jubilant about it. However, that summer, my stepfather left home, go downstairs to the barbershop, which was right around the corner from where I live, 47th and South Parkway at that time. Now it's King Drive, but it was 47th and South Parkway. To get a haircut. In the process of being in the chair, he keeled over, had a stroke. Took him to the hospital, and later he was paralyzed in his right hand. That's where he played most of the right hand. The left hand wasn't too well either. And this just painted a dark cloud over my days for going to the West Point. So I decided to stay home. I told Congressman Dawson that I couldn't go because of my situation here happening with me at home. And again, he asked me, sure? I told him I was sure. And he could find someone else to give the appointment to. So I got a job at the post office, because I'm a graduate now, working during the daytime, and that was okay, but I just wasn't making enough money for some reason. I guess I wanted to really get in and pitch out and help out since I had to take care of both my stepdad and my mom was only making minimum wages. I think she made about $30 a week on her job. So I got a job at the Chez Puri nightclub, which is now Navy Pier at that time. And I was parking cars at night. Got a chance to meet some top flight name artists such as Sammy Davis Jr., Tony Bennett, Frank Sinatra, Dean Martin, Jerry Lewis, just a few to name, and Nat King Cole, don't forget him. He was my buddy. In about 3 months parking cars there, one evening, I had a group to approach me, a group of kids. They were from Cabrini-Green, I found out later. They called themselves the Medallioneers. And they approached me because I was parking cars. I was the only Afro-American in the area, so they approached me about getting on the show. At that time, Sammy Davis Jr. was appearing there. So I told them, I said, let me speak to the manager. I'll see what I can do. I try to encourage them. I always try to do that with anybody. And not discourage him. I said, come back tomorrow night and I'll give you an answer. Hoping that they wouldn't show anymore, they came back the next night. And sort of got stuck with them because they asked me to come over to the rehearsal and see them perform, and maybe that would encourage me. I said, that's a good idea. I'll come over and see what you guys are really like. I went to Mercury Records at 80 East Wacker Drive. I took up their demo. We had a demo tape I took upstairs, and I met the A&R director, Chuck Sago. He listened to the group. He said, not bad, not bad at all. We have one group here, you know, the Platters. I said, oh, yeah, I know about the Platters. He said, but I'll give you guys a shot, give you a chance. The song was called Magic Moonlight. Within 2 weeks, we went to the studio, recorded Magic Moonlight. It was out on the streets, and we thought we were gone. I think we bought all the copies there was. That's how big a hit it was. It's a hit in our mind and our hearts. However, in the being in the Cabrini-Green area, I got a chance to go over to Washburn Trade School, where a lot of the talent was there. And happened that day, the Medallioneers appearing on a talent show. And there was another group there called the Roosters. And the Roosters took that show. They won that talent show. In the process, after the show, they asked me, being manager of the Medallioneers, would I manage them? I told Curtis and Jerry Butler at rehearsal one day, I said, you know, the name does not ring for the marquee, for the billboards. I can't see the Roosters up at the Regal Theater. I can't see that on the marquee. I said, when I met you guys, and your sound was not a doo-wop sound, you had a great sound. Your voices sound like instruments in the background, you know, real high voices, beautiful blend. I said, I was impressed, totally impressed with you. How about the impressions? It was unanimous, instantly unanimous, they agreed. Yeah, yeah, impressions. So that's how the name, the Impressions, came about. Unfortunately, I'm still a new kid on the block. I didn't go to the copyright office and have the name copywritten, as I should have done, and well, I paid for it later on. That's a school of hard knocks that I was attending, so that's how the Impressions name came about. So I went to the rehearsals and I'll talk with them. They said, we'll let you hear a couple of our special songs we got. We've been saving. We haven't did this publicly. They set up, did a song called Sweet Was the Wine. And then they came back with a song called For Your Precious Love. That song, as new as I was in the business, that song just knocked me out. For Your Precious Love. So we signed each other up, signed a contract with them. On notebook paper, of course, knowing a little about the business. I took them over to Record Row, which is on Michigan Avenue. We started at King Records, 13th and Wabash, and I saw Ralph Bass. Ralph Bass had James Brown, had Hank Bell and the Midnighters, didn't have any room for us. So my next stop was Chess Records. We're down to Chess Records, and we went in and rehearsed with them. We did every song but For Your Precious Love. We were scared to do that there because, you know, they were stealing material, stealing songs. So we did Sweet Was the Wine and a couple other songs. They said, nope, we can't help you. We've got Maurice and the Radiance, we've got Billy Stewart, we got Ramsey Lewis, and this sang Bo Diddley. Billy Stewart, they had a number of acts there, so they didn't need us either. Now I'm getting very disappointed. I said, well, we're going to make one more stop. We're going to go across the street. At that time, Record Row, VJ Records were right across the street. So we got up, packed up our guitar and went across the street. And we got a chance to talk to Calvin Carter. He's the brother of Vivian Carter of VJ Records, the owner. He was the A&R director. We did three songs. He said, you're close. You're missing something. Something. You got the voices. And I said, okay, we'll do For Your Precious Love. We did that song. He was excited. He jumped up out of his chair and said, that's a hit. Within 2 weeks, we recorded it, For Your Precious Love. Within another 2 weeks, it was out in the streets. The song took off like a rocket ship. However, the company realized that they had a great voice in Jerry Butler. They heard Jerry Butler. And they saw Jerry Butler being the next Roy Hamilton, who was a big artist at that time. They said, well, they went back room and put their hands together and decided how they could maneuver Jerry Butler out of the group. Which wasn't too hard because they offered Jerry Butler $2,000 cash. They gave him a brand new white Mercury. I don't forget that, brand new white Mercury. And Jerry Butler shook hands with him and said goodbye, fellas. That left us out in the streets. However, the one mistake they made that they didn't realize when they threw us all out, that in this group was a little kid named Curtis Mayfield. Okay? It took us 2 years to get back on our feet. We saved our monies and went into Universal Studios downtown in Russian Walton, and we recorded. We had a great arranger, by the way, named Johnny Payton. Can't forget Johnny Payton. He was a fantastic arranger. He stayed with us, too. And we recorded a song called Gypsy Woman, which we thought was fantastic. We were excited about it. Next step, I got on the plane and went to New York. Start shopping this master around. I went to RCA Victor Records. Didn't have any success there. I went to Lowry Records. They had U.S. Bonds, Gary U.S. Bonds, with Quarter Three. They didn't want anybody. I went to Scepter Records, no luck there. So I finally ended up at ABC Paramount Records, 1501 Broadway. Don't forget that. Sam Clark was the president, Larry New vice president. So I made an appointment to see them, and I took in Ruth Mysterio, Gypsy Woman. I said, yeah, it's good, but we just can't see a black group from Cabrini Green in Chicago singing about a gypsy woman. It just doesn't fit into the normal what the groups are doing. The groups are doing doo-wops. This is not a doo-wop record. And to my luck and to my blessing, there was a gentleman up there named Clarence Avant. And Clarence Avant is a music genius. He later, in years, became chief executive officer of Motown Records. That's how heavy he was. But he had two jazz artists at ABC Paramount at that time. And he listened to the song. He told them, give this guy a deal. Give him a deal. I know you're not going to give him any front money. Give him a deal. Put the record out. So they agreed. Because they said, well, we have nothing to lose. We'll put the record out. But we made one stipulation that I would have to promote it. Because they're not going to spend a dime on promotion. I said, well, Lord, I must say the prayer. Lord, I need you now, for sure. I went to Philadelphia, took it all the radio stations there, WDAS, WHAT, and then I went to Baltimore, WWIN, went to Washington, WUST. And these guys were so nice to me. I guess they felt sorry for me in a way because I wasn't the regular normal promotion man that came to see him, with pockets full of money. I came in broke. All I could do was take them to buy them a cup of coffee, a sandwich or something. But they liked me, I guess my personality and God was inside of me, I guess that touched them. And they played Gypsy Woman. It started in Philadelphia, and then this took off like a rocket ship. Read the Baltimore, Washington. That's all you needed was to get it started. The company would do the rest. They start putting it out on the national level, promoting the national level. And that was our big intro into the music business. They come to call me in within 6 months and ask me what I'd like to do promotion for them. National promotion. At that time, they had Fats Domino, Ray Charles, B.B. King, and Lloyd Price on the label. So it shouldn't be no problem with those guys having it on the label, along with, of course, my impressions. In the process of with ABC Paramount, national promotion executive, I got a chance to travel all over the world, fly in towns that I'd never been to, take the buses in towns I haven't been to. I went to the south, all down south, Atlanta, Charlotte, Birmingham, just everywhere. Great experience for me, and I got a chance to meet Ray Charles and be Ray Charles and work on this phenomenal album he had called I Can't Stop Loving You. This was a country and western album which turned the world upside down. I'm so happy about the success of this. We sold 5 or 6 million copies. Just incredible the way this album went. And so happy with Ray Charles. That was made him put him on the pop charts to stay forever and a day. Now I'm back in Chicago, and we decided to get our own office. Curtis and I were together. We decided to get our own office. So we had to find a place that we can set up shop at. So we looked around the city. And 85th and Stony Island, 8543 Stony Island, there was a law firm there. And this law firm was run by Edward R. Vidoliak. That was his office. And it was for sale. And we went in and inquired about it, and they told us they wanted $50,000 for the office. And Curtis and I said, yeah, that sounds great. Made a deal with Vidoliak. I went over to Steel Pier Bank over in his 10th ward and made close it out. And now this was the beginning of our own offices. Now, we decided to come up with a name for our company. And since Curtis, I always spoke to him as Kurt, and he referred to me as Tom. Okay, Tom, you like this song, Tom? I said, yeah, Kurt, I think you got something going there, you know. Great songwriter, genius, perhaps the world's greatest. So we together we put Kurt Tom. Yeah, Kurt Tom Records. Yeah, that sounds great. And we had our own artists, of course, the Impressions to start off with. Later we got Baby Hugh and the Babysitters, June Conquest, our first release by Charles Davis, a song called I'll Never Forget You, which we're going to play for him in a few minutes. We later went to Baby Hugh and the Babysitters. He was appearing up north here in one of the big theaters up here. Baby Hugh weighed about 380. That's why I'm calling Baby Hugh. He's a big guy, but he was a great artist. Great artist. We got a great band called the Babysitters. They were outstanding. We recorded a song on him called Mighty Mighty Spade and Whitey, which didn't do too well, but gave him a start. This was our Kurt Tom Records, and we went on to do a couple more things, and we decided, Curtis decided at that time that, you know, he came to me one evening and said, you know, Tom, I think I want to be a solo artist. I think I want to do my own thing. I said, well, I understand that. You know, you're a great writer, great singer. You have it all going for you, so why don't you follow your dreams, you know? So we amicably departed. Curtis came up north on Lincoln Avenue, and I stayed south. But Curtis' first record that he recorded, he said, I'm going to need some help, though. I need your help on this first record. I said, okay, you got it. What is it? He said, the song, we just did the movie, Superfly, and I'm writing all the music for it, and naturally, the song Superfly, we're going to need, we'll ask you to help more. I agree, and Superfly became a gigantic overnight smash. Solid gold, beautiful, beautiful, fantastic sales on that Superfly. Curtis is doing his thing on the north side, and I'm still on the south side. Later on, I decided to get some writers, because I had a lot of groups that were with me. Because when you're in promotion, you get everybody coming to you, whether you're promoting or not. The artists trying to find a home. So a group came to me, needed some material, but they weren't too good. They weren't too good at all. I had to make some changes. And it was called The Individuals. That's it, the group called The Individuals. I said, you guys need some material. And I knew that Jerry Butler had a workshop called Jerry Butler's Workshop, which he had a lot of songwriters over there writing songs for different artists nationwide. So I asked Jerry for some material, and he sent over two guys' names. One guy was Marvin Yancey. The other guy's name was Chuck Jackson. And they had some great material. But Chuck Jackson, he said, you know, you're doing promotion. We could have a group over here, have our own group. I said, yeah, we could do that. And he had a song here, Marvin just written, called Leaving Me. Leaving Me. I said, you know, are you guys in a recording contract with anyone? He said, no, we just write for Jerry, that's all. We're not in any contract. So I signed the two of them up on a recording contract. Went in the studio, got three other background singers come in. I hired three other background singers to come in and help us do this song, Leaving Me. And we finished the song. Now I'm off into the airplane again, headed for New York City. I end up at several record companies, but the one that really loved the record was Scepter Records. So it's called Scepter One. They had Dionne Warwick, B.J. Thomas on the label, so they were hot, along with the Shirelles. Yeah, those were the three top artists they had. So we signed a contract and put Leaving Me out. Bingo. First million seller. Leaving Me became a gold record right off the bat. And the reason why I named the group The Independents is because I was doing independent promotion for I have gone road travel. Any record company wanna need some help, come to me. I'm the man. I'll take care of it. So we did put the group together, Helen Curry, Chuck Jackson, and Maurice Jackson. Original Independents, I'm sorry. It was the three Independents. That's how we started. We recorded a lot of music for Scepter Records and did quite well. Now royalty time come, I figure they owe us at least $450,000 in royalties, at least, minimum. We had it all figured out, what we had sold, we knew. Okay, we got a call, a week later we got a call from Scepter Records that they are going bankrupt, okay? And there will be no royalties per se for us. What they did, they paid Dionne Warwick what they could because she was hooked up with Burke Bacharach. B.J. Thomas, I guess they took care of him. They figured, wait, with this little group in Chicago, somebody's going to have to bear the blow. And they passed us on the royalties. And now I'm in a huge dilemma because no funds, no capital. I can't pay the writers, Chuck and Marvin, I can't pay them. The group can't get paid. So that hit us real hard, real hard. So consequently, Chuck and Marvin took Natalie Cole themselves, took her to Capitol, made a deal with Capitol, and they produced her and et cetera. And that was the beginning of her career. This will be, I think, our first record. This will be, this one off the bat, off the charts, smash. So now I'm stuck there with my promotion coming. I'm still going strong, still going along with others. I get a call from New York, a company called AFCO Embassy Records. And they had a new group coming out of Philadelphia called the Stylistics. And they're just starting out, and Tom Bell and Leonard Cree were their producers and writers, phenomenal writers. They had a little record in Philadelphia called My Big Girl Now, which sold two records, I think. But once Tom Bell took over, I took him in the studio at the Embassy. They come up with a great sound, beautiful sound. And their first record, You Are Everything, Everything Is You, great Philadelphia sound. And I had the opportunity, the pleasure of promoting all of their music, and they're all gold and platinum, etc. So it was a great, great act. Also, out of that same Philadelphia area came another artist named Van McCoy. Van McCoy, on the same label, AFCO Embassy, had just finished his album, and he needed one more tune. He asked me, he said, you know, I got this tune, Eddie, what do you think about it? Because he was close to me, I really liked him, very close, he's a very religious person. It's called The Hustle. I said, yeah, play it for me. Play the demo. I said, that's a smash, man. Make sure you put that in the album. He recorded it, put it in the album, and came out after Embassy. I took it to Chicago, and the jocks were E. Rodney Jones, man, all the guys, they loved it. And it took off in Chicago, spread it worldwide, and The Hustle became a huge, huge instrumental smash, you know. That was just one of the records that came through that were well. I did a lot of other promotion records. Did the Manhattans, Johnny Taylor, Disco Lady. I did a lot of other records also that came through. Now, I came up with an idea. I said, you know, I was talking to the staff at the staff meeting. I said, we have disc jockeys here that spin records. I mean, local DJ, not on the radio station, that spin records in different clubs. I said, that would be a great promotional effort if we could unite them all under one banner so that we have our own private push for records. I knew I could convince the record companies to send me product. That would be no problem. The record companies saw how powerful we were. We got more companies sending us records than we could ever shake a stick at. So much product coming in. The guys were getting at least 50 records a week in their kit. The Dogs of War became a hot, hot item. Now I get a call from RSO Records. Al Corey was the president of that company. He said, you know, I've got a group here. We're doing well on the pop side, but I want to get them to go on the other side, the black market. They're called the Bee Gees. He said, we want to get that R&B market, you know? So he had me fly to California. I said, on top of me, and we played a lot of music. They had great music. They were great guys. So he started sending me records. Also was a movie called Saturday Night Fever. John Travolta was starring in that movie. And we got a chance to add another great song in there by the Tramps, Disco Inferno. Super hot. Anyway, the Bee Gees did You Should Be Dancing with that heavy, heavy beat. They were outstanding. And they went platinum right away, and the R&B market has opened the doors. In fact, friend of mine, Don Cornelius, who used to be in Chicago on a local TV station, I think it was Channel 44, WCIU, when he went to California and formed his Soul Train, he was using You Should Be Dancing when the kids got a chance to do their own strut down the middle of the aisle, you know. You Should Be Dancing was just perfect, and that just enhanced the sales even more so. But then they had other hit records, you know. They had so many smashes. It was a great thing. The Bee Gees went hot for us. Then we had the maestro himself. The maestro himself is gone but not forgotten. We call him BW. His name is Barry White. He just finished recording for 20th Century Records. Russ Regan, who was the president, called me up and asked me when I do the promotion on all his records. It's going to be my pleasure. He sent me some advanced copies. The first copy that I got of a record he's going to come out with called I Can't Get Enough of Your Love, Baby. Terrific, terrific. This is terrific music Barry made, great music. For Barry White, we had Peter Brown from Florida, TK Records, Hialeah, Florida, Evelyn Champagne King. We had naturally the master himself. We finally got the master, not maestro, the master, Quincy Jones. At that time, he wasn't quite big as he is now, but his first album, which was on A&M Records. A&M meant, let me tell you what A&M means. A means Herb Alpert, okay, who plays trumpet. His partner, Jerry Moss. So that's how A&M Records got their name, Alpert and Moss. And Quincy Jones had just did an album called Body Heat. And they sent me the album to promote. And bless your heart, it went gold right off the bat. They were so excited about it, they had me to come out to California for a huge party. And Quincy Jones had just come back from the hospital. I think he had brain surgery, if I'm not mistaken. Just come out of the hospital, he was really enthused about the surgery, first of all, being successful. And then his first gold album, Body Heat, went gold. And that was his first gold album of his career. I mean, he went on to do other things with Michael Jackson. I mean, his career has just extended beyond measure. Back to the Dogs of War. We were fortunate get some great artists to promote, so it was great for us also. We enjoyed helping these record companies. We had Donna Summers, which we were responsible for her album going gold. Donna Summers, then Evelyn Champagne King, Peter Brown, Do You Want to Get Funky With Me, that went gold. It was his first gold 12-inch. That was the album, it was a 12-inch at that time. Johnny Taylor, Disco Lady. I think you remember late Johnny Taylor, Disco Lady. That was one of our records we promoted. The Manhattans, Shining Star, BT Express. We had a great organization, a powerful organization. We had our own publication, a newspaper that went out worldwide. In the process of all these things that's happening, and an office I had still, I had an office on Staten Island, Stony Island, I decided to move locations, and I bought a building at 2112 South Michigan Avenue for my new office, 2112 South Michigan. Because now I got a huge office, a lot of activity down on Michigan Avenue. We got the Dogs of War, the independent promotions. So then I decided, I said, you know, so the Lord came to me one evening and said, you know what? You've got so many contacts out there. You're just loaded with contacts. They're all coming to Chicago, coming to town. You need to accommodate them with a limousine service. And that idea just hit me. Light turned on. Bingo. So went down and we leased three limousines, got three drivers, and we started using Thomas Associates as our corporation incorporated, and under that banner came promotion, came everything we did, Dogs of War. And we started Thomas Associates First Class Limousine Service, and we said, our punchline was, now you can sit in a lap of luxury. It's like I'm sitting in this chair, that's the way you felt in our limousines, and we got all the artists came to town, Quincy Jones, whatever artists came to town, they used our service. Smokey Robinson, we got tied up in Motown. We had all the services. And consequently, with all the artists, we got to get a lot of local business. At the same time, we did more than enough business with the Thomas Associates. That's our limousine service. And you have to be able to count your blessings. And I know God has blessed me over and over and over again because that's why I'm still here now, able to sit here with you and give you this brief message of my life in a capsule form because I couldn't give it to you. So I can't even remember all of it, you know, just so much involved. But and thank you all out there for listening and enjoying the program.
Now maybe someday I'll reach that higher goal. I know I can make it with just a little bit of soul. 'Cause I've got my strength and it don't make sense not to keep on pushing. Now look a look, look a look, a look a yonder.